My name is Sameena Azhar, and I'm an assistant professor at the Fordham University Graduate School of Social Service. So I'm an Indian Muslim female social worker. I hold a bachelor's degree in philosophy from UC Berkeley. That's unquestionably the academic achievement that I'm most proud of because it took me blood, sweat, and tears to complete. My academic interests are focused on the intersections between gender, HIV, mental health, and sex work, primarily in South Asia. Most of my clinical and research experience have been in the fields of HIV and addictions. So I've worked for several years at the STD control branch for the California Department of Public Health, and also as a clinical social worker at San Francisco General Hospital. Having worked in both policy and practice absolutely contributes to how I think about contemporary social problems.
Great. Well, and speaking of contemporary social problems, you recently published a paper in Athelia with other MFP doctoral fellows. Before we get into that, can you give a little bit of background about how that project took shape?
Yeah, so my colleagues and friends who are involved in this publication are Anne Farina at Seattle University, Antonia Alvarez at Portland State University, and Susan Klumpner at the University of Maryland, Baltimore. We all met each other through CSWE's Minority Fellowship Program back in 2015, and we became fast friends. We shared an interest in advancing issues regarding Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders in social work. And we noticed that there was virtually no recognition of our communities in social work education, and to a large degree, also in mainstream social work practice and research. So the following year was a presidential election, and there was a huge rise in xenophobic rhetoric from then presidential candidate Donald J. Trump. At that time, New York Times columnist Michael Lowe had shared his own experiences with microaggressions in New York City and called on Asian Americans to share their own experiences as well on Twitter using the hashtag #ThisIs2016. So our study really looked at the tweets that were using this hashtag, #ThisIs2016. So we conducted a content analysis of over 3,000 tweets and looked at, specifically for the paper and Aphilia, themes that were related to intersectional stereotypes of Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. There are other themes that we explored elsewhere, but this paper particularly looks at intersectional themes around gender and sexuality.
Great. What was it like to collaborate with these friends on this type of project? As you said, you know, like you're now at different institutions, and you were at different institutions going into this. So, what was that process like of a national collaboration in that way?
No, that's an excellent question. I mean, I think that we all had very different experiences at our home institutions in terms of how research mentorship was structured, or how research collaboration was structured. So I think going in, we were very intentional about wanting it to be a space where all of our views were equitably shared, where authorship was equitably shared. So really recreating the type of social work research paradigms that, for the most part, we hadn't seen, in our own education. So I think also the fact that we all come from, you know, fairly different backgrounds. There's a little bit of ethnic overlap, but yeah, we're all quite distinct in our identities and had, you know, different experiences in different parts of the country as Asian Americans. So I think that contributes to how we are able to look at issues perhaps from different perspectives, but at the same time, all sharing this identity of being API social workers.
Yes, very much so. And so in your study, you really focused on, or you identified six main themes, talking about sexualization, weakness, objects of violence. And I think I saw your paper, or it popped up in my feed, I think the week that the Atlanta mass shootings took place, which I don't know, talk about a contemporary social problem, but it seemed really timely in an unfortunate way. So what's it been like for you to see your work come to life in the midst of now a new hashtag of Stop Asian Hate?
Yeah. I mean, first of all, completely unexpected, right? No one wants to see the research on racism come to life. And yet on the other hand, it was really expected because we've been researching these sort of time-worn stereotypes that have existed really for centuries. So I think it's simply unavoidable to be a person, and especially a woman of color in America, and not realize how we're perpetually othered in a myriad of ways, from how we're portrayed by Hollywood to how we're portrayed by politicians. So a recurring theme in our analysis was our perpetual foreignness. Mm-hmm. I was born in the Bronx. I grew up in Southern California. Yet I and so many other of my Asian American Pacific Islander colleagues are continually asked throughout their lives, mm-hmm. you know, but where are you really from? As if our Americanness has only been borrowed and is not authentic. So in this past year, this has also been coupled with stereotypes regarding Asian Americans being carriers of COVID-19. Mm-hmm. And the novel coronavirus has been pejoratively labeled by the former president as the China virus and the Kung flu. And now we have really good evidence that this politicized and racist rhetoric contributed to an increase in hate crimes against Asian American communities. So my own research outside of this project also examines stereotypes about sex workers, mm-hmm. And Asian women working in particular service industries, particularly massage parlors, are often assumed to be sex workers.
Right.
And while that assumption in and of itself is problematic, we can also couple that with the conclusion that if you are a sex worker, you should be expected to be treated in dehumanizing ways. And I think mm-hmm. that assumption is equally problematic too.
Right.
I think in sum, it's been just a little bit, I don't even know how to describe. So if I'm surprised or if I'm jarred by how much this Atlanta shooting has resonated with folks in a way that other murders in the past have not, right? So, I mean, we have so many examples of other murders.
Right, right.
So what happened here? And I'm still not completely sure. Maybe it's the fact that, you know, we're in a pandemic, we have more time to think about these things. Maybe there was something about the idea of six Asian women being murdered at once. It's hard to pinpoint, but something for sure resonated with folks even outside of the API community with these murders. And I think I think that it became a catalyst in a lot of ways that even the hashtag Stop Asian Hate before these murders had not incited amongst the general population.
Right, and that there's a visibility to it, and I think some of it is the visibility of Black Lives Matter and how that has, and that took some time to get that sort of widespread level of acceptance or widespread embrace of it. And that's right. Probably also been something that has helped in this process, because there's this recognition that it is race-based. And as you say, that there's that piece of, well, not just sexualization, but that aspect of being the forever foreigner concept, that Asian Americans can be otherized very easily because of skin color, because of our names, regardless of where one is born, if you were born in the US or if you were not born in the US, there's always going to be that piece.
Yeah, I totally agree that there is a strong connection with the Black Lives Matter movement. And I don't see them being as one or the other. You know, I think that there's a truly intersectional nature to these social movements and the ways in which they really bleed into each other naturally, as they should, right. because they share the oppression of people of color in America. So I think those connections should be made.
Yeah.
Maybe perhaps more so than they already are.
Right, right. We need to be more intentional in how we build those connections and build those bridges and build those bonds.
Right.
So, you know, to take an inward look into the social work profession, one of the things that the MFP fellows that write in the paper is you point out about the silos that those divisions between scholars and activists and defining social work practitioner roles and educator roles and researcher roles. So from your perspective, how do we collectively break out of these divides to move social work education forward, especially in light of these Asian hate crimes, these race-based murders? Where do we go from here?
Right. I mean, I think there's so many silos, right? There's silos between academia and activism. There's silos between micro and macro or policy and practice. And I think it's really, in general, tough to break out of these silos because our profession or professions at large really reward specialization, right? That you need to know a niche topic very well. And an old tradition in the social sciences was that you couldn't really engage in activism because it diminished your objectivity as a scientist or as a scholar. And I just reject that notion, right? And I'm an academic in social work because I want to see the world change for the better. I want to see the world become less racist, to have stronger social entitlements, to have an improved public healthcare system. And I didn't enter this field to navel gaze, right? Or to engage in what some might call poverty porn. So this is really important for me as a social work scholar. I don't want to take part in research that objectifies communities of color as subjects and removes our agency from us. And having worked in HIV for so long, I really saw that take place a lot, you know, where communities become target populations for an intervention and labeled as at risk, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm really inspired by the words of Black queer feminist Audre Lorde, as so many of us are, right? Who wrote, "There's no such thing as a single issue struggle because we do not live single issue lives." And I can't just work on issues related to the oppression of Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders without also working on issues related to the oppression of Black, Indigenous, and Latinx communities. So as critical race theory teaches us, these issues are integrally related to one another and very important to how I want to see the future of social work go.